Tears have fascinated humanity since antiquity. They have been addressed in poetry, literature, and religious writings, paintings, music, and cinema. I will talk about tears, their many uses, how they are produced, and how they are drained. Welcome to Faces, your medical and surgical guide to the head and neck. There are three basic types of tears. Basal production, that lubricates the eye and conjunctiva and is part of our immune barriers. Reflex tears, for flushing out external irritants. And emotional tears. About the latter, I will invite you to watch the side story on this video channel and take a look at Faces website. The lacrimal gland lies at the upper external corner of the orbit and is responsible for 90% of tear secretion. The remaining 10% is produced by accessory glands placed in the eyelids. Tears leave the conjunctival surface through two holes, the lacrimal punctum. Those acquainted with eye contact lenses and eye makeup have certainly noted them. These holes drain to a lacrimal sac and then to a duct, by which the fluid is conveyed into the cavity of the nose. There are a few valves along this pathway to avoid reflux back to the eye. An excess of tears during reflex or emotional tears causes the nose to run, and when exceeding the lacrimal draining capacity, tears will fall from the eyelid onto the cheek. And the medical term for tearing overflow is epiphora. Having watery eyes affects daily activities such as reading, driving, outdoor walking, watching television or computer work. It may be caused by an excess of basal tear production or their insufficient drainage. Let me talk about the latter one, because those are the cases I get referred to. An obstruction in nasal lacrimal system will result in a stagnation of tears and epiphora. Stagnation provides a favorable environment for infectious organisms to propagate and debris to form, leading to a local infection named dacryocystitis. There can be an obstruction at any level of the nasal lacrimal system for several reasons: local debris, local trauma, lacrimal stones, and systemic diseases such as autoimmune diseases. In adults, it occurs usually above 40 years old, and females represent around 70% of all cases because their lacrimal conduct tends to be narrower. During acute infection episodes, it may be necessary to use antibiotic therapy. In chronic dacryocystitis, it's almost always managed surgically. Whatever the case, it is highly recommended to visit an ophthalmologist before referring to a surgeon. Surgery is usually performed under general anesthesia, and the approach can be done entirely inside the nose using an endoscope or combined with a small skin incision. A silicone tube is placed in the lacrimal conduct and left there during a few weeks to prevent reocclusion. When for some reason it's not possible to restore the duct due to trauma, oncological cases, or very fibrotic ducts, a new channel can be opened in the inner corner of the eye. Patients leave hospital the same or the next day and should avoid strenuous activities to prevent unnecessary nose bleeding. For patients unfit for general anesthesia, there are other possible surgical approaches and managements. So, you've seen how tears are produced, how they are drained, and the management of drainage problems. This is part of a bigger topic called orbital surgery and oculoplastic surgery. Visit Faces website at www.faces.pt and take a look at some topics like orbital tumors and Graves' disease. I hope you liked the video and thank you for watching.